run the home stretch. Heather Grimes, Internal Services. And so while the morning's been all about doom and gloom, I hope to turn the corner to positivity because I get to talk about the organization and our best resource are our employees. And so we have about 2,200 employees. That's up since the downfall of 2009, because at some point we were under 2,000 employees. So we're about 2,200 now, serving our 500,000 residents through 57 lines of business. 31.6% have some form of post-secondary education. When we did our last strategic plan update, that was only about 24%. So we've grown about 7% in our workforce with some form of post-secondary education. And then in fiscal year 2016, 12% of our workforce celebrated more than 20 years of dedicated service. 4 years ago, that number was larger than 20%. I forget the exact number off the top of my head, but that basically says if it feels like there's a lot of new people, there are, because a whole lot of people retired in the last 4 years. So turnover for last year was about 14%, but it's still lower than the national average of 16.5%. And 337 new employees were hired. And we didn't terminate 313 people. That's just the term of art for if somebody resigned. 73% of those were retirements. Couple little brief snippets from the employee engagement survey. You've probably seen a lot of these already. And we asked the question, overall, I'm satisfied with my job. The short story here is that continually every year creeps a little bit up every single year. In 2015, that was 71%. In 2016, that's up to 74% of positive responses. This one's a really interesting question. So we ask, in general, in comparison to last year, things are better, the same, or worse. And what it basically says is they're not the same, because we went up, which is bad, from 12.75% in 15 to 16.13% in 16, but we also went up and things are better than last year. So I think this says, depending on your department division, things are not the same, but in some cases they're better and in some cases they're worse. And so those percentages, for those of you in the back of the room that can't read this, for better than last year in 2015, we're about 32%. And in 16, it's about 41% that's better than last year. So, interesting. And then the last one I have here is we ask our employees if they would recommend this organization to their friends and family as a place to work. And that, too, had a slight uptick up between 2015 and 16. And what we've seen over the past couple of years is that, in general, that number increases just a little bit. So collectively, over the past couple of years, that number's a lot larger of an increase. And Mark?
Cool. So again, every year we produce a business plan, and the business plan is designed to show the body of work we intend to do over that year that moves us closer to achieving the four-year strategic plan. At the end of each year, for an accountability's sake, we produce an annual report that says how well we did those things we set out to do. This, again, is online, and you can get it. Just want to show a few highlights of it, as we did to the board. Great work continues to be done, and Heather's right. This is where we started the positive uptick in the presentation, because flat budgets, skeleton crews, you guys and your teams are still winning awards out there, still being recognized regionally and nationally for the outstanding efforts of everyone. Please celebrate this with your teams. Don't just let it go by as something, well, we got this year. Make it a big deal. Make it a big deal. It was big to the board. They're glad to see this stuff. The end report is basically set up to talk in terms of what we set out to do, how well did we do it. So you'll see the icons in it. Talks about the green one at the top. The work has been completed, meeting its results. The next one is it will be completed in the time intended. It isn't done yet as of the printing of the report. The next one is it's ongoing. We have a lot of things in the business plans that are 2-, 3-, 4-year initiatives that take time to do, but they are on track that way. And then the work is not completed was the X. The good news is that out of the 69 action plans in the plan itself, 33% were completed as intended, 16% will be, and 45% were actually ongoing. There's a lot of long-term plans in there. I will say that as we move forward, particularly with the board we have now, we're going to be looking at more bite-sized pieces so that at the end of a year, we can really say, here is what you set for us to do, here is what we did. Not we did this much of it and it continues on. So we're going to be looking at drilling this down in a more meaningful way that the board and the citizens can understand. This is just a page of how the deal's set up. The one thing we wanted to make sure that the board understood real clearly is we've made some huge, huge strides in turning the culture of the organization that we're no longer that broke, fixed mentality. We're not just reactive anymore. And you heard examples of that this morning with the programs that presented. We're looking at ways to get ahead of things before they break, to solve problems before they become problems. So the board needed to hear us say that, yes, we get it, and we're doing everything all ahead full in that realm. And that the idea of understanding our customer requirements, understanding what their needs are, minimum, and then what our targets are, help us to make sure that customer satisfaction is always a part of what we focus on. So we did spend some time with them on this piece. The other parts of the report, and this is something they like too, by the numbers, just by sheer volume, we do a huge amount of work. And this piece of the annual report shows by the numbers how many riders we had in buses, how many computers we have, how much money we brought in for this, and how much roads we paved, all that type of stuff. And the biggest piece in here is recognizing our folks who won awards throughout the year, and that's the last section of that report. Really good stuff, really important to share with them. They all have a copy, hard copy of it. Again, you can print this off online if you want to do that. So the highlights, and we did spend a lot of time hitting this because, again, there are ideas that we weren't really hitting the customer service piece, is that our customer service focus has been increasing and exponentially year after year for about the past 5, 6, 7 years. And they were actually surprised. The first time we actually put the number in front of them for the comment cards was in last year's plan. And it was still 94%, 93% positive. And that blew them away. Because what do they receive on their desks? Oh, the negative ones. And as Michelle said, they see one and think, well, that everybody must be bad in that department. But here, we're seeing that out of 2,500 cards, 93% were positive. And think about what it takes for someone to write a positive comment. Think about how we act. We got good service, great, got good service, move on. But you have to have really good service, and Kathy does an illustration of that for the LDP that's really great, to where service was so far above and beyond that you had to write something. You had to comment. You had to tell a manager. So keep in mind that when they're positive, that's probably more positive than what you might normally get. The other things we talked about in the report, what's happening with the economy, things happening, the Pasco EDC is helping out by increasing our businesses and so forth. We're investing in the things we need to. There's some big projects going on. Great work is happening day in and day out in the county. We also shared the SWOT analysis that you guys and your whole team did, everyone in the organization having an opportunity. And the things that we pointed out, you've all seen this before, the biggest thing we pointed out is that, A, we're doing things right. We just have 30 years of catching up to do. So we are taking care of folks today. You look at our benefits package, and they asked, and it was interesting to see them ask specific questions about competing on salary. And no, we will never compete with the private sector on salary alone. We can't. But start putting our benefits package up there and comparing it, and you'll see that what we have to offer is better, A, than the private sector and better than most other governments. So when you're recruiting, keep that in mind. Put these things on the table because it's a big deal. And they were happy to hear that. The other thing we pointed out on here is we have been living, and it was some tough talk, we have been living in an environment where we have the Nordstrom expectation and we've got the Walmart budget. And so this plan, as we designed it this year, has got to be realistic. And when the board was doing their interviews with the consultant, the third party, we made sure that whatever you are saying focus on, you will also be willing to talk money and fund. So as we come back with this draft plan, that becomes the piece we have to put on the table. You want this done, here's what it's going to take. Do you want it level A, B, or C? But you need to fund level A, B, or C. So again, it's tough. And I get their position. They inherited this, but we've got to solve it. Okay.
Todd Bailey, Information Technology. This is the, so IT made the chart for the environmental scan. We're very cross-threaded through the vast majority of our business lines, and every one of our new employees that comes on board, and even our customers, brings a more digital focus with them into our environment. So apologize for the eye chart, but the main focus here is that the vast majority of services in our business and across the county are going up. You can see that the physical landlines are going down, however, our smartphones are replacing those, and those are building back up. The initial focus to the board was concentrated on the amount of project work that we do. We have a limited number of staff, obviously. We completed about 36 major projects in the past 4 years. We average about 12 major projects a year. Some of them are multi-year projects, as you're all aware. And we govern those and we prioritize those through our Enterprise Technology Committee meeting with the county administrator and ACUS once per month. So we do evaluate and reprioritize projects as we roll through. A couple of catch-up notes here that we presented to the board. We were delinquent in our financial system. We had three separate unique systems, as you all are aware. We consolidated those into the Tyler Munis ERP system, ERP being an acronym for Enterprise Resource Planning, fancy name for finance system. Our land management system, which is, as you all are aware of, is known as Excella Automation. Still a work in progress. The first phase is complete. New phases are coming on board. And we're trying to bring our computing infrastructure up to date, and you all can read that. We're focusing on cloud, software as a service, shared services, virtual desktops. And this year, we're going to be putting more emphasis on a mobile device management structure, for not only for cybersecurity reasons, but to ensure that our organization is staying HIPAA and PCI, which is payment card industry compliant, as well as protecting our personal information and data. So it's that intellectual property that we have to ensure as statutes change and we need to become more transparent to the public. So we'll be challenged, again, as I alluded to in the beginning, with the social media presence that's getting pushed upon us, and as more employees want to use their own personal devices, and the more demand for tablets and companion devices, which we're seeing a large shift in, especially in the ITBR orders in the budget this year, is that most folks are not only want their desktop or their powerful laptop, but they're opting for either a tablet or a Surface Pro as a companion device as they travel around. So that increments and increases our licensing counts. However, we understand that if it services the customer better, there's a business case there. So because of growing use of public networks and delivery of our services, our challenge of protecting the internal network is ongoing. As you're aware, we created a cybersecurity office in the past 2 years. And the increase of video and social media and government settings for collaboration purposes. So as we venture out and try to do more intergovernment collaboration in the future with our neighbors to try to leverage those synergies of applications and our effort to service our citizens better, our landscape's going to change, so we're trying to stay ahead of that. Thank you.
Back again. So far what you've seen was put together very, very purposely. Purposefully, yes. Reason being, we, the content experts, know what needs to happen, not just to operate the county today, but move it on into the future. So it was up to us to come up with the numbers, the statistics, the current realities, and then what we project the needs are going to be moving forward. So that was the first part of the scan. It's a lot of information, tons of it, but it is great information, and it's what the board needed to hear to understand where we are and where we need to go. Now what we do, the last part here, the last two pieces, we balance that against what are the citizens telling us? What are the customers saying to us? So that's the piece we got into here. You saw me present this before, but the highlights in here were around the National Citizen Survey, of course, that we do, and then the online survey. The fact that we got a very, very good sample from both in this last year, which tells us that this information is really pretty accurate in what they're telling us and what they believe we need to be doing. The distribution of the surveys across the county and responses was also very, very good. The most, of course, being where the highest population area are, but it was really a good sample across the boards. The one thing that changed this year from last year is that, of course, public safety, number one, is always probably will be. Number two, though, was mobility. Economy moved to number three. Economy, it's pretty apparent things are now moving in the right direction, so there's not as much angst around that. Mobility, there is a lot of angst around that because that includes the condition of the roads, it includes traffic, it includes public transportation, it includes trails, all the things you heard about today and all the things that we presented needs for. The citizens are saying, yep, it's big for us, it's important to us. And so as we looked at a couple of the things that were really important to us too, the overall quality of services provided by Pasco County, that number has continued to move up. The blue line is the National Citizen Survey, which is the random, much more solid sample because you have a good chance of getting people that think we're doing a pretty good job. The opt-in often is people who want to voice a different opinion. But even that, good comparisons, and that continues to move up. The other part was in support of everything that you've heard so far, if we look at outside of law enforcement, fire rescue, emergency services, what are the most important services we provide in the citizen's mind? Again, top two, number one, far and away, road maintenance, number two, code enforcement. Take a look, Park and Rec is right behind that. So now the whole quality of life piece is moving up the line. So there again, something that the board needs to understand. So if we just break down those three really quickly here, safety, mobility, and the economy, if you look at the safety piece, interestingly enough, the overall feeling of safety in Pasco County has been trending down since 14, but the quality of the emergency services provided in Pasco County continues to go up. That could be just kind of where the world is today. When you look at the economic piece, people are feeling pretty good. Most of these dimensions went up. Cost of living is in good shape. Shopping opportunities in good shape. The only two, and we see them every year, that the citizens say are not good is the number of employment opportunities, and then, of course, Pasco County is a place to work. There's just not enough hair. Everybody travels south to go to work for the most part. When we look at the mobility piece, road repair, public transportation, we rank very, very, very low as compared to the other counties that participate and ask this question in the National Citizen Survey. Of course, that is a concern, but it also shares a reality with the board that we've got a ways to go. We spent so much time building and not maintaining. We've got an awful lot of catch up to do with maintaining. So if you look at some conclusions here, the ratings are generally poorest on the west. So we talk about redevelopment that in that area, and we sort of focused on that at the workshop as well. And looking at where we need to invest our money based on all of the information that's been seen, you can see around road and bridge, transportation, economic development, and code enforcement as well. We also did push this a little bit here, defining premier. The one thing I'll point out to you guys that we pointed out to them that was interesting is, if you recall in the survey, we asked, what do you consider to be premier? Help us to rank these items. And there was a whole listing here Ernie and his group helped put together, but talking about adequately maintains infrastructure, superior parks, all these different dimensions. And the very interesting part, and I'll show you on this last one, is that the areas that scored lowest in here, interestingly enough, things like safe and efficient traffic flow, eliminating blight, adequately maintains infrastructure. Why do you suppose those got the lowest ratings? Ben said it. Because we're talking about defining premier. Those things right there should be in place no matter what, let alone bumping it up to premier. So the things that they were looking at around premier were things like outstanding government programs, neighborhoods that include a wide variety of housing, superior parks, facilities, and programs, a healthy mixture of land uses, healthy communities, all those things then define premier. So the citizens backed up that whole piece that we still got work to do here before we're going to get to that premier level. So that was really the overarching message that we need to look at that bigger picture. Ratings for services continue to go up. Again, share that with your teams. Flat budget, skeleton crews, great work is being done every day. The data proves it. And let your teams know that the citizens now see it, and they're telling us in the surveys as well. All right, so one more piece here with community engagement. Richard.
Thank you, Mark. The process was set up on a slideshow.
Richard, and, you have to be at the podium for the video.
For the screen, for the slideshow, and the slideshow had a parallel piece that you may not have received, but there is a document that was attached to this agenda. Paula and Gina put it together, taking 176 very exciting slides and putting them into a format that tells a really fascinating story of all this data. So if you go online to the agenda of the 31st for the workshop, electronically this is available, and Polly may send one of these to Hannah, and she could send it to this group, so you had one in your email, because it's pretty good presentation of all of what has been covered here in this immersion. In the SWOT process, which you all participated in, I think what's really important is that your SWOT as an employee group is very, very close to what the general citizen said. And there is a process of going out to the community, and we have found over the years that, you know, the citizens are actually great planners. They know where the problems are and they identify them. So strengths and weaknesses, which are internal issues, they were sensitive to, and opportunities and threats, which were external, they were sensitive to. But hundreds of people came out to about 24 meetings that were held through June I actually have one more left to do that we're working on with PEDC. There's a format that we used that had, as you know, wherever two or more gathered, we had a meeting, but we had up to, I think about 38 was the largest attendance in a group. So in this format, which the button is right here, the strengths that they were pursuing follow a framework of natural environment, agriculture, workforce, and education and infrastructure. Good place to live. Lots of natural features and areas. Great land preservation program. We have over 20% of the county in some form of public ownership and control, from the green swamp to the to major park systems and well field systems. There is a diversity but balance in agriculture. There's a desire for more innovation and leadership. This community was focusing on workforce is expanding, education is expanding. There's a diverse workforce. It's going to be a younger workforce. In infrastructure, quality of life is an issue. Focus on by the community. They saw the penny funds, which they had approved by an over 70% approval, as a tool to bring more jobs to the county, which they're positive about. But at the same time, they see a lower taxes affordability aspect as something very positive. So we're always in this balance of people have this higher degree of expectation, but they also want us to in service, but they like the lower cost to be here. When you shift to the weaknesses, they were a little more aggressive. This was the highest amount of response, the major area of concern. And what we did here is, with all the responses, all the ones that people waited, remember, whenever you took this, you could take and put your three colored buttons on the three things that were most important. So when you do this with hundreds of people across 20-some meetings, these are the ones that got those additional ratings. So infrastructure, taking care of residences, getting those programs in place, transit routes, being pedestrian friendly, getting more smart planning in place, addressing blight, quality of life issues, and concentrating on areas that have poor appearance, building and permitting issues could be expedited. So in this infrastructure side, that was a very consistent area of weakness. Public trust, there was a desire for the board to have a stronger, more transparent government relationship, and they were very emphatic about that. And in economic development, diversity and options for residents, address pockets of poverty. In the area of agriculture, and we do have a balance. You know, 250,000 acres of our county are generally going towards development, but 250,000 acres of our county are in some form of conservation, preservation, and agriculture. So the agriculture group came out very aggressively in this discussion, wanting us to see that we maintain that balance and we keep an agricultural image and don't become one of these urban counties that are asphalted from side to side. Quality of life, major commitments to our involvement and improvement in certain areas. Tourism and entertainment, without me advocating it, they were asking us to, you know, raise the tourist tax. Marketing, image brand is something where we need more social media exposure. And in organizational issues, they recognized that our pay rates were low. The citizens commented that pay rates for PESCO personnel are too low, and it's reflected in our customer service. So the general citizen understands that they need to do a better effort in those areas. Organizational issues were high, but shifting to opportunities, they had a format where they saw us having the opportunity to revitalize certain areas, to get a much stronger cooperative work program with our budding governments. Pasco needs is part of Tampa Bay and needs to be more involved. They saw redevelopment of 19 as a key, and while everybody stresses that, we don't have a redevelopment-based organization that focuses. We put great investment in new growth, but a marginal amount in redevelopment. We need to stress that. Education, our apprenticeship program has been recognized nationally. Economic development, we have a lot of new activity and new investment going on throughout the county. More tourism, community issues, create new communities. People are very excited about the activity. Some people react to it as overpaving or too much growth in the county. Others see it as us becoming, you know, the future of Tampa Bay. This involvement is key. Citizens want to be involved. Agriculture, again, was a key concern that we maintain it. In the threats area, they took offense at the commission needing to have, you know, more ethics, more involvement, less good old boy. There was a lot of concern for leadership that would allow for more citizen input. So actually in our citizen involvement, our outreach and legislation, we're also focusing with programs like the Citizens Academy and other activities for citizens to have a hands-on, stronger involvement in the future of the county. And people want more of that. Perceptions of neighboring areas, getting our quality image up is a key. Having something that says it would take us 300 years to solve it does not send that message. So there, and Bob got a little bit beat up the other day about talking about a lack of whatever it was, appetite for revenue. There's no way to get to some of these issues without dealing with these revenue questions. And the citizens raise those points. Economic development, the first thing, lack of revenue, need to create new revenue sources. So the citizens understand those. Public safety is still a very key thing, and people do have blight and crime concerns. Funding provisions are limited due to the way some of the state structure and cuts that are lost from $30 billion to $20 billion in the ratable base is very constrained by the legislative power that was put on us that you can't increase more than that percent of inflation. So while the whole market value fell out of all the housing, we can't get it back in except in that indicator to the rate of inflation. The pockets of poverty and funding and support for social services was the key. I think the citizens did reflect that we had a positive attitude towards solving our problems. We had activity in every area. They were just looking for more, very vocal about more revenue to solve more problems aggressively, and a very positive image was presented. In my close to the commission, I outlined that the fact that we started this in 07-08 with the ULI and we're continuing it in five-year intervals has also been a good trend for us to define how we were going to become a great place. So the new administrator, whoever comes in the selection process that they will do to replace the county administrator, will have, I think, a strong plan based on this background document. And I would ask you to take a look at this, because it's a great piece you could put in your lobby or circulate with your employees to look at in a way that they can digest it at their leisure. And it's a good story.
So we know we went long today, but we thought it was really important that you all saw this environmental scan information. It really does tell the whole story about the county and what our needs are and where we're going forward.